de vous accueillir à l'Académie diplomatique de Vienne, qui a été créée en 1754. Donc c'est la plus vieille académie diplomatique du monde. Et comme vous le voyez, il y a encore beaucoup de choses que vous pouvez découvrir dans le hall d'entrée. Welcome to the Vienna Diplomatic Academy. It has been created in 1754 and it's the oldest diplomatic academy in the world. You can see already in the main hall here the clothes that the students were wearing at the time. It's here. Les habits qu'ils portaient avant, les étudiants, ils portaient des vestes et tout cela, comme vous voyez aujourd'hui, mais ça fait bien longtemps de cela. Voilà, et puis ici, nous avons le tableau qu'on appelle le Hall of Fame, le tableau des meilleurs étudiants de l'Académie. Vous allez remarquer, à ce niveau, Marie-Roger Biloa, que beaucoup de Camerounais connaissent, qui est présidente de plusieurs magazines et institutions de presse. Et voilà qu'elle était ici en 1979. Elle a été cooptée dans le Hall of Fame, c'est-à-dire les meilleurs étudiants de tous les temps de l'Académie diplomatique de Vienne. Je pense que c'est suffisamment important pour être mentionné. So this is the Hall, Alumni Hall of Fame of the Academy, and you can see that there is a Cameroonian, Marie-Roger Biloa, who was inducted in 1979 as one of the best students in the history of this prestigious school. So I think it's important to notice that. It's very important. Today we are going to talk about the birth of the OAU, how the OAU was born. And I think it's important to go back to the different stages. By doing that, you will understand that there's a big misunderstanding, what I call the quiproquo of Addis Ababa. What obtained in Addis Ababa was very different from what actually appeared to be. So we're going to do that. But for now, I'm just going to stress, compared to what was done yesterday, the role of Ethiopia in all this. Ethiopia, as you can see, has been selected as the seat of the Organization of African Unity since 1963. But before that, Ethiopia was the only country that actually attended the two diplomatic conferences which will be presented to you in a few minutes. The one which was held in Casablanca in January 1961, and the one which was held in Monrovia in May 1961 also. Ethiopia sent delegates to both because invitations were sent to all free African countries, to all independent African countries. And she took advantage of that disposition to actually attend both. And as a result, it behooved on Ethiopian diplomats to draft what was called after the Addis Ababa Charter, which was a compromise between the Casablanca Charter and the Monrovia Charter. They could not have been in a position to do so had they not been in attendance following the debate and so on. So Ethiopia had that particular intuition. The second peculiarity about Ethiopia is that it had the moral legitimacy to gather and to mediate among the fighting diplomatic communities. Soon we'll talk about the content of the fighting. Why was there a disagreement between all of them? But Ethiopia had the legitimacy because for Casablanca, which was insisting on the dignity of Africa, on the history of an African, which is not subject to colonization and so on, Ethiopia, for the Casablanca group, was precisely the example of that kind of Africa. So Haile Selassie I was the embodiment of that kind of Africa, which the Casablanca group really was advocating. And now for the group of the Monrovia group, also, Ethiopia, being an empire, was a conservative country, of course. I don't know of an emperor who's a revolutionary. So most emperors tend to be conservatives. So in that account, Ethiopia could fit the two bills and took advantage of that position as a bridge to actually put forward her experienced diplomatic machinery. Third, only Ethiopia had an experienced diplomatic tool. Liberia could also, but hers were shorter in terms of experience. So the Ethiopian diplomats were experienced, they were used to negotiation, and they were used to drafting all kinds of text, diplomatic text. So, as I said, that was the third point. Ethiopia was in a position to do so. Now, how to convene the conference? Again, once Haile Selassie I decided that the conference would be convened, Ethiopia had Ethiopian Airlines. It's as simple as that. Ethiopian Airlines was able to go everywhere in every capital in Africa to deliver the imperial message of invitation. At the time, Ethiopian Airlines was created in the early 1940s. So it's an old airline as well. So you see that all this concurred towards establishing Ethiopia as a place where mediation would come, and she also had the will to do that. And now yesterday we talked about, of course, the other mystical dimension which many Africans like to have, to add. And in that particular case, I brought forward the sermon of Reverend Webb, who said that, I don't know whether it was in the Bible or not, but I've looked in the Bible, I didn't see that, where they said that a black king will be soon brought to the fore, and he will liberate the African continent. So that was in 1921. The coronation of the emperor took place a few years later, 1930. And then they were quick to make a link between that prophecy, I would say, and Rastafari Makonnen, who became emperor of Ethiopia. So all this explains in a way why Ethiopia has had a special place. But to me, and that is my personal opinion, is that the culture of Ethiopia also helps a lot. It is a culture of people who are uncaptured. It's difficult to capture their soul. They have their own religion, They have their own national official language. They have their own timetable. They have their own history, which is written in Amharic. And they have their own time frame. As I told you maybe the other day, some of you might have been there, that if an Ethiopian tells you, lady, I want to meet you at 3 o'clock in the morning, please do not panic. Don't think that you are talking to someone who's looking for trouble. Because 3 o'clock meaning simply 3 hours after sunrise. That is to say for them after 6 o'clock. So when they say 3 o'clock, it means the appointment is at 9 o'clock, which is a reasonable time to meet a lady or to meet a friend for maybe breakfast or late breakfast. So you see all these peculiarities, in my view, explain why it's difficult. Even today, when you go to Ethiopia, they will speak in English to you for maybe 1 month. After that, the same person who spoke to you in English would declare himself incapable of uttering a single word in English. So it's an invitation for you to learn Amharic. And in fact, it's one of the few places in Africa where I've seen foreigners of all provenance quickly and in a masterful way speak Amharic. So it means that it's just a question of will. I remember your position the other day concerning an African language. It's just a matter of will. So all this has given, Addis Ababa today is with 120 diplomatic missions and headquarters of international organizations, Addis Ababa is today unquestionably the diplomatic capital of Africa. Okay? Because in Addis Ababa, you have the AU, former OAU, the AU today, but you also have the United Nations Economic Commission for Africa, which is headquartered in Addis Ababa. So if you take the two, on top of that, you have also about 100 NGOs which are there. So if you add them all up, it's a huge number of foreign, diplomatic, international community gathered in one place. Yes, sir. Nairobi is the second United Nations point of concentration in Africa. It's the UNEP, it's the United Nations environment policy structure of the United Nations there. But unlike Addis Ababa, Nairobi does not have the 55 African states present in terms of diplomatic representation. They don't. The truth is that many of them are based in Addis Ababa with diplomatic jurisdiction in Kenya. It's less expensive to do that for many African states. Okay, but it's true that Nairobi is a very important diplomatic point in Africa today, capital in Africa. Okay, you're right. Okay, so I think that's what I wanted to say concerning a bit the bridge between the two, what we said yesterday and what we're saying today. All right, so I will open up if you have questions concerning yesterday, and I think that we are getting closer to our, yes, please come in, getting closer to the end of this this presentation. Yes.
I have a question on Ethiopia and Eritrea. What constitutes the Habesha people, and how does this constitution justify the existence of Eritrea?
Eritrea is an annexation. It was annexed by Ethiopia. It's clear. It was not Ethiopian territory. I think it was in the 1940s that it happened. And therefore, it was a colony of Italy, Eritrea. And if you go today to Eritrea, you will see what they built and everything there. But the truth of the matter is that the Eritreans and the Ethiopians, they are the same people. They are exactly the same people. You can say they are cousins, first degree cousins, if you will. The food, the culture, the habits, the language, the religion, it's the same thing.
Language can be, because they speak Tigrinya.
Yeah.
But that's not the same as
Amharic. But it's true, but in Ethiopia you have also the Tigrinya in Ethiopia too. So it's part of Ethiopia also. So it's the same culture. That's what I'm saying. But it's true that the majority do not speak Amharic, because Amharic is closer to Addis Ababa geographically. But the Tigrinyans are part of the Ethiopian culture also. I don't know. I don't know. But to me, the point is that it's a federal republic. I mean, many people don't know that. It's a federal republic with each republic having its own flag, its own anthem, and so on. But it's true that it is not so decentralized. And I think this is one of the key points where protests, especially the Oromos are very, very, very vocal about their dissent. And that's why they were given to power, and they were able to calm down a little bit. They complained about the Amharic hegemony. I don't know whether it's true, but the king, I mean the Ethiopian emperors, come from Amhara land. So, and this for centuries after centuries. So I'm sure they protest that. They don't agree that they should be under their tutelage for so long. It's also normal. But to me, it's the same family. I think it's to you, I said to you that one year, maybe it was in 2000, I don't know, I went to Asmara with Ethiopian Airlines. And then the year after, I was asked to go through Djibouti, taking Mauritius Airlines, because Ethiopian had no longer access to Eritrea after they had been confronting each other. So there comes a time when we must grow up and then make sure that these kind of things are behind us. It's a question of will, but it's also a question of listening to what the people at the root level want. I think there's a lot of that. Most of the pilots of Ethiopian Airlines are from Eritrea, so they had a problem to staff their crews. They couldn't do it immediately. Okay. All right. Eritrea is of course also the way to the sea. When you cut off Eritrea from Ethiopia becomes a landlocked country. And that was a real problem for them. So they had to work basically with Djibouti. Ethiopia then had new accords and agreements with Djibouti to have access to the Gulf of Aden. Otherwise they were not able to get to reach the sea. Okay, so it's a major geostrategic problem for them. Mm. All right.
For Africans to unite, basically what I am understanding is there's a need for Africans to renew our minds. There's a need for African schools, African universities, African primary schools and colleges to push forward what Africa is all about, and to renew the mindset of not interfering in other countries' affairs, because to get Africa as a united community, there's that need for togetherness, there's that need for us to come together as one, there's that need for us to leave the dependence on other Western countries and embrace our culture, embrace our roots, embrace those who have fought for the independence of Africa, those who have brought Africa to where it is now. There's nothing that's impossible. Today, when we look at Africa, 60 years on, we are still being called developing countries, but there's still hope. There's still hope if we come together as one. There's still hope if we decide that, no, we are putting our feet down. We are propagating what Africa is all about, what we are all about as a continent to the youth, because Agenda 2063 should target these children and help them understand that there's more to the continent. There's more. We have wealth that is in abundance that we can use for our own benefit. We need not depend on others. Corruption and other things that have become a canker to us, we can overcome them.
Hello, my name is Alexandra and I'm a student at the Diplomatic Academy of Vienna. Right now I'm attending a course by Professor Pondi, who is teaching about the dynamics of African integration. And what we discussed there is a lot about cooperation, how important the cooperation between different African states is, what the role of Pan-Africanism means for African states today, but also how the responsibility of Europe also comes into play, and how states out of Africa today and nowadays should support African and intra-African cooperation for the better into the future, as we need a lot of cooperation nowadays to have a prosper and global future altogether.
My name is Jack. I come from the USA. I think studying African politics and the progress of Africa as a whole is incredibly important, because I believe there are two very different futures Africa has, depending on how the people of Africa behave and depending on how the politicians of Africa guide the continent. There is a very bright future where they are able to grow economically and politically and be able to use the incredible wealth the continent has to offer the world. And on the other hand, if people act out of selfishness, if they behave in a greedy manner, if they act cynically, they can end up destroying themselves. I'm not sure which way it'll go, because I do not know enough about how things are on the ground, but I hope for a bright future, and I hope for one where there is peace and stability. I believe it is more important in a way to study Africa than Europe, even. I think Europe is kind of still viewed as a power just because of its historicity, as being a powerful continent, but I think that era is gone, and where it moves now is really up to Africa.